Today we're talking about law and order, the political idea, not the NBC show. You might have heard your parents or media figures or politicians use the phrase, and it's a very philosophically loaded term. So we're going to examine it and also touch on the very interesting question, do you always have to obey the law? We begin with political theorist, philosopher, and Nazi Carl Schmitt, who said that sovereignty, the state of being in charge of a political system, lies in the ability to decide on the exception to the rules, to decide when to suspend the normal rights, regulations, and procedures and just make a decision. In that moment, the sovereign is like a dictator, kind of like a god, Schmitt said, which might be why he went in for the whole Nazi thing. But for our purposes, what's interesting is that to decide on the exception is also to decide on what is normal. To draw a line around some cases and say, these are exceptional, is implicitly to draw a line around everything else and say, this is normal. Schmitt himself writes, "For a legal order to make sense, a normal situation must exist, and he is sovereign who definitely decides whether this normal situation actually exists." And it's that normal that can be very, very interesting. Because depending on who you are, normality, the status quo, can be a very good thing, or it can be a very bad thing. For instance, in the USA, it used to be normal that racial segregation was legally enforced. Black people and white people would have separate entrances to public buildings, separate water fountains, separate seating areas, and if you were a person of color caught in a white space, you could end up in serious legal trouble. It's also worth mentioning that although they were supposed to be separate but equal, the facilities for people of color were almost invariably much worse. When the civil rights and black power movements tried to end this, white supremacists said that changing the system would undermine law and order. And so in that case, defending law and order became a coded way of saying you wanted to defend racial segregation and oppression. The black power revolutionary Kwame Ture said, "Hitler had the most efficient system of law and order we've ever seen. He happens to have been a fascist. He did not have justice coupled with his law and order. The United States knows about law and order. It does not know about justice." In that case, not in all necessarily, but definitely in that one, law and order meant enforcing white supremacy. That's an example of how appealing to law and order can be appealing to a normal that is a very partisan state of affairs. ContraPoints has an excellent video on how the response to the 2015 Baltimore uprising similarly included a lot of coded racial references to law and order. Speaking of uprisings, holding up law and order as the goal rules out civil disobedience as a tactic for changing the system. If you defend the law, then you oppose breaking the law. But there's a long history of breaking the law being used for good, like the Irish Revolution, the Jamaican slave revolt, the Haitian slave revolt, the American Civil Rights Movement itself, and Gandhi's Salt March. All of them, they are just a few examples, involved breaking the law. And if the people involved had stuck to obeying the law, they wouldn't have happened. In his letter from a Birmingham jail, American civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. writes that the biggest obstacle to black liberation is not the white citizen's counselor or the Ku Klux Klanner, but the white moderate, who is more devoted to order than to justice, who prefers a negative peace which is the absence of tension to a positive peace which is the presence of justice, who constantly says, "I agree with you in the goal you seek, but I cannot agree with your methods of direct action," who paternalistically believes that he can set the timetable for another man's freedom. A lot of parallels to Ture going on there. Law and order also usually means supporting traditional policing and imprisonment, which rules out alternative methods of community organizing that people might prefer, like police abolition or anarchism, which are perfectly respectable positions that we could talk about, but appealing to law and order as the goal rules those out. This brings us to that interesting question of whether you always have to obey the law. And the answer to that is that it will depend on what you think the law is. If you think that the normal situation is good and just, and that the law exists to uphold that normal situation, then you probably think that people should obey the law. If, on the other hand, you think that the law itself is unjust, or even as some thinkers have done, that an unjust law isn't a real law, then you might think that there are some circumstances in which it's okay or even necessary to break it. The philosopher H.L.A. Hart said that the law is whatever those who set the law say it is. This position is called legal positivism, because the law is whatever is posited by those who are in charge. There are no moral constraints on what a law can say. The only thing that makes a rule into a law is the so-called rule of recognition, the master rule which ring-fences all others. The rule of recognition might be something very simple, like everything in the Constitution is the law, or it might be very complex, even unstated. If Hart is right, then a rule could be unfair and unjust, but still be the law so long as the rule of recognition recognizes it. So similarly, appealing to law and order might be appealing to an unjust or unfair standard. Contrast that with the approach of philosophers like Lon Fuller and John Finnis, who say that if a rule is in some way bad, or doesn't make sense, or doesn't meet certain other criteria, then it's not properly a law. This position is called natural law theory, and it used to be very popular with religious thinkers like St. Augustine as well. He thought that if a law on earth didn't really correspond to the law of God, then we couldn't really call it a law. And natural law theorists nowadays often just develop secular versions of that idea. For them, appealing to law and order might be appealing to a warped or twisted rule that you have in your head. It's not appealing to true law and true order. Legal positivism versus natural law theory is a bigger debate than we have time to get into here, but my point is that when people use the phrase law and order, there's a lot of political, moral, and historical work that is being hidden in just those three words. That might be why it's such a popular political platform.
Law and order. Law and order. Law and order. Law and order.
Because people can read whatever they want into it. Something else that might be worth bearing in mind is that although laws are written down in a very cut and dry way with a clear line between what's legal and what's illegal, practically speaking, there can sometimes be a little bit of leeway. So I was at a protest a while ago, which, because we went outside the zone we were supposed to be in, was technically an illegal protest, and we were told, oh, if you stay here, you're going to be arrested, and so on. So, like, technically we were breaking the law, but the police gave us a little bit of leeway with the degree to which they were going to enforce that. So it was worth bearing in mind when talking about the law that sometimes it's a little bit more arbitrary than we might expect. Another example might be if you technically were parked on the double yellow line, but then the parking warden's there and you say, oh, come on, it was only 2 minutes, it was an emergency, and they let you off. Like, technically it's illegal, but actually, practically speaking, you got away with it. Often, at least when it's enforced on the streets, the law is what philosopher Joseph Raz calls a content-independent reason. Raz thinks that the law doesn't take a bunch of reasons, consider them, and then make a judgment. The law takes a bunch of reasons and then replaces them with authority. You don't obey the law because it is considered and wise and just, but because it is the law and will be enforced. At least, that's what he says the law wants you to do. An appeal to law and order is an appeal to that authority and that force, whether or not it happens to be correct. So just bear that in mind next time you hear someone talk about law and order. Make sure you do the philosophy, otherwise you might well find that other people are all too willing to do it for you.
Law!
In this video, we've explored the philosophical and historical baggage behind the idea of law and order, and we've also touched on the question of whether you always have to obey the law. Patreon.com/philosophytube is where the fans of the show make sure that I can continue eating and paying rent and creating this content, so if you can help me out with that, I would love you to sign up. And don't forget to subscribe.